You have to start now.
Okay. So, my name is Dori Adar. I'm really happy to be here. I am the founder of Hands On Games. Hands On Games is a gaming school based in Tel Aviv. I'm an indie game developer. I do UX design and gamification for organizations. And I am a gamer. I play a lot. I'm really, really happy and blessed that play has a big role in my life. And I would actually like to tell you about a specific night that we are having in my apartment. This is the night that I'm really looking forward to every week. It's the game night. It's the night where we gather together, good friends, drink some, smoke some, have a blast, and play games all night. Now, this specific event, my girlfriend, she was then entering her ninth month of pregnancy, second pregnancy, a fact that we did our best to completely deny. Not think about the fact that she's about to give birth. This was at least my way of dealing with it. And on this night, approximately at 11 o'clock, she started feeling pains repeatedly. She said labor pains. Of course, she was losing the game, so it was probably just an excuse. But after a while, she insisted it has nothing to do with that game and that this is actually happening. Now, because of the fact that we were not ready at all mentally, also physically, you have to prepare a bag, for example, if you want to go give birth in a hospital. You want to make, I don't know, bring pistachios, bring something in a bag. You have to take care of the other kid that is sleeping in the room. You have to do stuff. So the next 10 minutes after we've realized that this is actually happening were very chaotic. Imagine two headless chickens running in the kitchen doing weird stuff, bringing this, bringing that. I told my friends, look, you have to stay because somebody has to take care of the kid. And I remember I have like a very vivid memory of me trying to wrap a way too small plastic bag over the trash can, struggling it with it for a few minutes, then lifting my head. And this is what I see. So, these are my friends. That's what's happening. Yes, they are playing Clash Royale on their phones. When behind them, the miracle of birth is about to begin. At home, as it seemed like at the moment, but they are really in the game. So I had two thoughts. What?
You were filming it.
I was filming it because I was astonished that that's what's happening in my house while my girlfriend is about to give birth in the kitchen. To me, this was like I could not bear the. Okay, so I filmed it. Yes, I did film it. Very professionally, if I may say so myself. And I had two thoughts. Well, first of all, yes, how can you do that? And B, I envied them so much because my world was falling apart, very chaotic. You never know what's going to happen. Their decisions are very accurate. There's this game, they are reacting to the game. I would have loved to be in their position. And I told myself, okay, if we go through this, which we did, if we go through this, I'm going back to Clash Royale because I left the game a while ago. And this time, I am not going to get addicted like these people, because now I know all the behavioral tricks playing on my mind, and I know that I can overcome them, and I'll just enjoy the game. So, three months later, this is actually my son's birthday. And I think there's like 2 hours here, okay? This is the span of 2 hours. And yes, this is me very hooked on Clash Royale. Indeed, I failed. And this is going to be the talk for today. It's called Psychology at Play. the good, the bad, and the ugly. Let's start with the good stuff, okay? Games puts us in control. This is one game I really love. It's called Istanbul. Any board game players here? I didn't ask. I'm in Europe. This is amazing. Do you know this game? It's called Istanbul. You nod. Okay, it's a great game. But I want to tell you what games are for me, okay? Because games are for me, they are a closed system of accurate rules, mechanics, and goals. And this is something that is very reassuring, okay? When you do something in a game, you know what to expect, more or less. Unlike my life. So this is Hebrew. You can't read this, but this is like I took a snapshot of my tasks. This is actually the first one is buying plane tickets to Cologne, which is okay. I could have done this task, but this one, how do you, I don't know how to say it in English, but how do you establish a website called creative.com? It's an idea I had. I don't even know where to start. This one is searching for kindergartens and schools for my son. I cannot even express how difficult this thing is. How not unproportionately difficult. How do you even deal with this? I should roll out a few proposals. I should, very unnerving. So compared to this, I am very in control playing games, very in control. Games are finite, okay? Not infinite. They have a finite set of rules. This is very reassuring. Clear goals, clear rules, logical, very systematic. If you raise kids, you know that nothing here is there, okay? Fails are embraced, and while failing, well, it promotes creative thinking, okay? Because you try again. Now, I know there's this cliche about entrepreneurs saying fail fast. Failing sucks, and you know it. When you fail, it doesn't feel like, yeah, I failed fast. And most of the time, you didn't even know that you failed, because failure is something that lasts long until you realize that you're not adrift, you're sinking. It takes a while to understand this. So in games, you fail, and that's great because you learn, you try again. This is great. Provokes flow. Flow is this thing, the state of mind you are in when you are playing a game, for example, or having this talk. Time means nothing, right? You are so in your zone doing the things that you are doing that this is a great place to be in, like mentally. Games are skill building, they build skill, they enhance communication and social skills. Very, very great things about games that puts us in control. Now, if you search online or learned a little bit about motivation, you might know this theory, which is called the self-determination theory. It's from the 70s, but still very applicable to now. And it stands on three legs. Relatedness, this is a community, really. To be appreciated by our peers, by our colleagues, by our friends, family. This is something that really motivates us as human beings. Of course, competence, being good at something, getting better at something, could be like overcome challenges at work and life. This is very a motivating thing. And of course, autonomy. Nobody loves that people tell them what to do. I mean, the fact that you can decide on your own actions is really motivating. And games, they tap on every leg, right? They enhance communication and social skills. They enhance skill building. And of course, autonomy. Everybody plays in his own way and doing his own actions and acting by his own decisions. So these are all great things. And this is why Jane McConnell, one of my the designers I look up to, she said gameplay is the direct emotional opposite of depression, and I really think this is true. So this is all very, very good things about games. But of course, you can't have only the good without the bad. So games can get out of control. Back to Istanbul. So, or back to me again. My favorite topic. So I run a small business. I raised two kids, and I live in the 10th most expensive city in the world, which is Tel Aviv. Life are intense, and I cannot code. So life are intense. And I have to say that sometimes when I have to take decisions, which are big decisions, I kind of close my eyes and I drift to Istanbul. I imagine the little pieces on the board. I imagine my moves on the board and how the cards feel in my hand. And this is really escapism. And I've been doing that quite a lot recently. And not to mention video games, which I also play, usually indie titles like 10-hour campaign. But when I start a campaign, this really gets a hold on my thoughts. And I really have to finish the game. Otherwise, I cannot do anything else. And that's really escapism. That's procrastination. Lack of focus sometimes during work as I'm thinking about the games, or sometimes because I'm my own boss playing these games during work. And of course, time consuming. But that's okay, you know, that's okay, because these games at least have an end, which is something you cannot say about most games today. And here we come to the ugly, where games control us. So, short story. Back in the day, 10 years ago, I was managing a small video website called Flix, never mind. And we had this woman called Lital. She was a marketing professional. And at certain point, I remember she started showing up very late to work, and she had these circles around her eyes. And I politely asked what happened, and then not very politely, because she wouldn't tell. And then she told me, look, okay, it's been like this for 2 weeks because I have to wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning to work in my field of corn. Now, as far as I knew, she was living in Tel Aviv. We do not have these type of things. Harvest the crops, she used that term. So she was talking about this game, Farmville, and Farmville has made her do that. It has made her wake up in an unrational, not rational hour and do that, because if she wouldn't have harvested the crop, they would die. And what would her friends think? Like a Facebook friends. So I was like, oh my God, I really need to check out games now, because the way I remembered games back in the day, 10 years ago, they were not doing this to people. You were doing other things in games. So I checked it out. At the time, I did not understand it, but now I do. And Farmville used punishments and rewards to really design their users' behavior. And they were probably the pioneers doing that. They were extremely successful. They had 12 million users at their height, I think. And when Facebook did their IPO, we learned that Zynga, the company behind this game, was responsible for 25% of Facebook's income. And they did not do it via advertisement, but via in-app purchases, real money for buying virtual goods. And my mind was blown away. I said, okay, this industry, I want in. And here I am, right? So they were the pioneers, and they were actually only making the grounds for what came later under this guy's supervision. You know this guy, former Atari employee, the genius from Cupertino, Steve Jobs, the one who took the gaming industry and turned it on its head with the App Store. And in the App Store, well, most games are free. They're called F2P, that's free to play, and they're just given away. And free games took in $88 billion in 2018, last year. There are more than a million free games on the app stores. You can just go and download, and this created a new type of gamer, the browser gamer, which means, me included, go into the App Store, download a handful of free games, play 1 minute each, and never to return again. And this has made game companies to become something else. Game companies in the F2P zone are now hunters. They are hunting and fishing for whales. Whales? Players who spend a great deal on in-app purchases. What is a great deal, you ask? Well, it could be $20 a day, it could be hundreds of dollars a day. These are whales. And how do game companies get to people spend so much money on an app, on virtual good? How do they do that? By penetrating in their routine and having them have, this is a weird way to say it, a spend habit, okay? So this is a habit loop. If you've read books about habits, if you are somewhat interested in this topic, you may know it. If you have bad habits, you obviously know it, because it goes like this all the time. It starts with a cue, then there is a routine, and then there is a reward. Let's take smoking, for example. So if you are a smoker, it is usually attached to another habit of yours. Let's say you finished eating. And then that's the cue, and then you go out to the terrace and you smoke a cigarette, and then you get this reward because it's rewarding smoking a cigarette. You feel good, the nicotine and everything. And this positive reinforcement, it makes the next time that it makes this action desirable. So the next time you finish lunch, you are already feeling the reward in the tips of your finger. And this goes on and on and on. And smokers, they have many cues. You smoke after something every time. And it can also be the 3 o'clock cookie that you do because it's 3 o'clock. Oh, let's have this bite and cookie. And it can also be like every habit. It starts with a cue, and then there's the routine, and then there's the reward. And game makers know that. And now I'm going to show you a few tricks how they penetrate into people's habit loops by using cues and rewards. So how games control us? With rewards, unfinished businesses, attainable goals, sense of progress, and social engagement. And I'm going to walk through this right now. So rewards. I want you to think a little bit about rewards. What are rewards? What is the purpose of rewards in your lives? Think about it for a second. Because the answer is surprising. Let's say, for example, I'm on the beach with my family and it's time to go. It's really time to go. It's 7 o'clock already. And my kid, he's 3 years old, he doesn't want to go. So he does the tantrum act. Do you know what a tantrum is? This is laying on the sand, crying, like embarrassedly crying, and tossing sand in his eyes. Okay, this is like a normal tantrum, okay? and you have to deal with it. And at some point you say, hey, kid, you know I have this chocolate in my bag, and even before I finish the word bag, the boy is in the car. So what are rewards? Rewards are means of control. I am the oppressor using rewards to make you do as I want. These are rewards. So, let's play a game. I've been talking too much, not playing makes Dori a dull boy. Volunteer I need. Who wants to play a game with me? Come on. No, not all together, not all together. You have to film this. I asked for a volunteer to play a game with me. Nobody raised their hands.
Do you have a chocolate?
You've been listening. We're kind of hoping for more participants, so please raise your hands. Yes. Come. Yeah, you are. You are no stranger for this stage. So, okay, so I was told there's a lag, so please stand here and take this and wait, okay? So I actually did this yesterday, I have to say.
Not with me.
No. So this is the lucky 7P. I've heard that casinos are actually legal here in Germany. So what you have to do is to press X to tap on the left piggy and tap on, Yeah, so that's the gameplay.
Huh? What?
Play the game. Play it. I will go. Play the game. We have time.
What?
Just play the game. Yeah, play the game.
I can't tell if it's wrong.
I don't feel like I'm winning.
Oh, you are.
Play the game. We have time. That's okay.
Okay. This is constant. I can do it.
You're good. Okay, could you play some more, please?
All right.
Let's see. Now, let's see if this would work. Interesting. So, the right pig, thank you very much. You did amazingly well.
Wow.
The right pig, yes. The right pig gives variable numbers, whereas this pig gives constant numbers. Now, I was kind of hoping that the difference would be bigger. However, it is always happens that the variable reward gets more clicks. Why? Because it's a surprise. It's variable. This is a way of control. How much time do I have?
Just have to check.
No, maybe you have a meeting.
No.
Maybe you have to go.
No, anyway.
Okay. No, I'm kidding. I'm just having fun. So, where were we, though?
I got a notification.
So, variable rewards is just one way, no, I'm not using this, of actually controlling players. And this game, Clash Royale, it is all about variable rewards. Because when you win these treasure chests, and inside there are different cards. Some of them are legendary, like this one that I unlocked, which is a great joy. And I don't know, I'm serious. I mean, you don't get to see these. And when it happens, it's fabulous. You have all these colors and music and everything. So they constantly offer variable rewards to control players' behavior. Now, unfinished business. This is something that it really happens on games. And this is the fact that you don't get the reward immediately. So in Clash Royale, you win the reward after you've won a battle, for example, but then you have to wait 90 minutes until you can get to see what's inside. So imagine this, okay? You buy something at the store, they give you the box, you don't know what's inside, you want to open it, but no, you have to wait an hour and a half. And then after an hour and a half, they notify you about it, okay? They say, hey, silver chest unlocked. And if you ignore them, crown chest available, time to battle. And then you have, okay, free rewards are waiting for you. I mean, come on, just come in and get them. And this is very compelling. Timers, backed with notifications, will get the game into the player's daily routine. And this is funny because this is the routine. You play the game, but you do not get it here. Rather, you get it here. Animation. Rewards are served as cues, okay? And after you do it a while, this is really nice also because the first impression from you playing the game is having this reward, which is a very good thing, is a positive reinforcement, and then you do the routine, and then you win another reward, but only for later. So this is how really they program themselves into my routine. Attainable goals. So games, free-to-play games, are all about attainable goals. Now look here, for example. See how close I am to this reward? This is another battle. Immediately another battle. This is all I need to get this, and I want this, because this would upgrade my cards. So I will do the battle, and if I lose, I go a little bit further, and then I have now I really have to get the reward. Or this one, I remember the Gold Rush event very vividly, because when it was on, I was like, haha, this is not working on me. And a day after, I was playing like crazy, because it was about to end. Only 2 days. And they do it on the weekend. And the weekend, it's like family time. And I think that this event was in my kid's birthday. because I was rushing out the gold. I'm telling you, I was so rich after that weekend. And of course, these, like all the timers, all the time, look how many do you have. The season ends in 9 days. This has like 10 more to get to the maximum. This, the tier 33, if you reach to it, it's in 9 hours and 3 minutes and 32 seconds to be exact. This really taps on my OCD, I'm telling you. So these are attainable goals. It's really, really compelling. Yeah, this is just writing what I'm just saying, so we can move on. Sense of progress. So you really get to progress in this game, which is also really nice, because in real life, you hardly sense your progress. I mean, you do, but not like this. I mean, this is really quantified. You begin with a certain amount of trophies, and then you gain more. And I'm telling you, seriously, there's this satisfaction of improving and seeing myself like further on the ladder. And this makes things even easier, even harder when you want to leave this game. Because after you've made so much progress, when you think about leaving, you're like, wait, I'm leaving all of this behind. I've progressed so much. I have so many legendary cards. This is called the sunk cost fallacy. And you know it when you're standing in line behind this person in the supermarket who starts with the coupons and doesn't leave, but you don't leave the queue because you invested in this queue. So that's that, like in major scale. And the coupons never stop. Social engagement, that's the last one. This is actually clan war, okay? So me and my buddies are here on this boat, and basically it's a cooperative thing where we are supposed, we have like 2 days or like however time is left, and we are supposed to get as many prizes for the clan, and then we can claim them and use them. And there's a real peer pressure on it. When there's a war, like my WhatsApp goes crazy, and where are you? Why are you not in? And why are you not, you know, winning prizes for the team and take 1, 2, 5 hours for the team and stuff? So this is really, really hard. And even games that don't have this social engagement baked into the game mechanics, they really tap on that. I mean, Israel is notoriously known for social casino games. And I know that, I'll ask you, what is the most lucrative game day, sorry, what is the most lucrative day in the life of a social casino game? What is it? Think about it.
First payment day.
What? First payment? No. Any more ideas?
Birthday?
Okay. Birthday, it's no. Saturday. It's one day. Saturday's Valentine's Day. And this, because in Valentine's Day, if you are lonely, you may feel a little less lonely playing these games. So this is true, this is happening, and social engagement has a lot to do with behavioral addiction. So these are the causes for behavioral addiction eventually, because this is where it all leads to. It's rewards and unfinished businesses, business, attainable goals, sense of progress, and social engagement. These are some quotes of friends of mine about playing this game. I play where I am not supposed to, in between meetings, taking longer toilet breaks. This is a CEO of a medical device startup. I cannot stop if I'm on a winning streak, and if I lose, I just want to get back to the position I was in before. That's my friend. He's a business developer in a big pharma company. I have no problem with this. I play only 30 to 60 minutes per day. That's my friend A. He is a showrunner, and he's also not saying the truth, because when we looked in his phone, we found out that he spent around 3 hours per day on the game. But say, no, I'm not playing. When I'm on the game, I can chat with other people, I can upgrade my cards. This is not, upgrading a card is not playing, right? Because you're not battling. So this is really, I find it hilarious. So it is a problem. These are not good feelings toward games. So we have every reason to be pessimistic, guys. Seriously. Behavioral addiction is real. people are addicted to their phones, their games, their digital services, and over the expense of families, friends, and other things that do us good. We cannot expect regulation. I mean, as far as I know, the legislator or the guys in the government, they don't hire game designers. They cannot know what's happening inside, and if they would try to involve in it, this would be considered as a dictatorship. It will not fly. We cannot expect self-regulation. I've been working in this industry for 10 years now. And when I was a creative director in this big company, I would have loved to make my bosses happy with my job, obviously. I mean, I would not say, hey, let's not put in this mechanic. This is way too addictive. No way. I want to be good in my job. I have two kids and a family. I want to earn well. So we cannot expect self-regulation. And also, data analysis and collection are better than ever. We have so much data, and now we can actually analyze it and know which car works better, which mechanic works better, which character users like, and so on and so forth. And of course, it's not only games. Games were always the pioneers, always. We had chatbots like way before the UX persons discovered chatbots and stuff like that. So these mechanics and way of use of psychological tricks, it's on Facebook, it's on Uber, it's on Snapchat, everywhere use it, so it's all around thing. However, there are some good things, like public awareness, maybe this talk, books about it, and even this app that shows you now integrated into iOS that actually shows you where you spend your time in. Premium services, people begin to pay for games again with subscription models or actually paying up front for premium games, and premium games just don't have these black hat tricks. Self-awareness. So I deleted Clash Royale about a month ago because I had like this talk to repair and like I had stuff to do. And this is funny because the first week I was cold turkey. This is real. I was itching to play the game all the time. And it faded away. It faded away. After a few days it faded away, and now I do a little bit, but usually I don't feel the need of actually playing the game. So this is also happening. And we have to remember that the ugly can be put to good use. I mean, by themselves, these are all goods. We can use rewards for good, good purposes. And of course, all these and other good things about games. For example, this game called Sea Hero Quest is a game like any other, but it is also different because when you play the game, your data is being sent to this laboratory in California, and they track your performance in the game. And this is used for a huge research on dementia. And what they are able to collect in 5 minutes of play is like interviewing 100 people. So this is amazing. This is really putting games to good use. And also apps like Fabulous, they take a lot of inspiration from games and they try to make you live better. Like actually achieve your goals and not the game's goal. Exercise more, meditate, do stuff that you are feeling good with. And this is a game that I've made. It's a game about recycling. It teaches people how to recycle. Israel has a huge recycling problem as we are not recycling. And we don't even know where the packages should go because we live in the desert, really. So this game teaches people how to recycle. And we had 500,000 users last summer. And this actually improved recycling rates by 3%, which is huge. It's a huge number. So we can put these things, these tactics, to good use. Thank you very much, guys. It was awesome.
Is this mic working? Questions? Until those, exactly. All right.
There are certain countries in Europe that are planning to ban loot boxes and stuff like that. Do you think that's a good approach?
Yeah, they have. Belgium and the Netherlands. but they're banning it for tax reasons. No, seriously, I mean, they are banning loot boxes because you can, it's like gambling. You pay, you win a random prize, and then you go and sell it on a third-party market, and this is what they ban. They cannot and will not ban virtual goods that cannot be sold on platforms. So it's more of like we want a piece of that money approach rather than actually dealing with behavioral addiction.
All right, you can move the mic at some random location. In the meantime, just raise your hand. I just wanted to mention, you mentioned the battery usage, which is something I speak in my talk, so I was happy to see it as well. I wanted to say there is another thing which you have to think about, especially if you have kids on iOS, it's screen time. Like I use screen time for my kids. They have 2 hours per day for all apps, and out of this, only 1 hour for games. I even think it's too much. Use it especially. Any other question?
What technologies did you use to develop the games? Game engine or
I can tell you, but then I have to kill you. No, this is I'm not a developer, which makes me an illiterate to you people. And I use Construct. Construct is a very high level HTML game engine where you don't have to use code if you don't want to, and you just write. It has like its own code, but it's really logic based. And I can show you its interface since you've asked, and it's open. And this is very convenient. This is like the way it looks, but this is my code. And it's like I have functions and it's very logical, and I made this game in 20 minutes yesterday. So it's really, really, really fast.
And you can decide which platform do you prefer?
Can you use the mic?
No.
Yes. Yeah, please use it, otherwise on the video people don't hear you.
It's not a problem.
It is a problem for us. Please use the mic. Thank you.
You have to turn the mic on.
Yeah, that's another problem. Now it's on. Now it's on.
Right now? No. This.
Yeah.
No. Yes.
No.
Good then. Maybe it's off. Maybe it's turned off. Whatever. Is it red?
It's red, yes.
Whatever. Good.
And you can choose a platform for what you develop the game.
Yeah, here, let me export. This is so
it's
funny.
It's like Scratch for adults.
This is so funny, I'm talking about like technical stuff. But this is HTML5, so this is easy for the web. And of course, Facebook Instant Games, I did a few playable ads with it because it's all HTML5. And then you can get a wrapper for Cordova, iOS, and even you can do Xbox One stuff with it. It's very powerful. It can be used professionally for game making. And I use it mainly for prototyping to show people what I, like the real developers, what I want to do. And then they take it and they actually build it.
I was going to say, or you can hire an iOS developer so that it makes it in not Cordova.
Of course. I mean, I don't even believe you said this word in the SwiftCon conference.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Swift Cordova. Swift Cordova.
Yeah. Yeah. Any more questions?
Well, there is the next question. I think. While you're checking the mic, I have a question for you. It's about analytics. You mentioned Uber at Ego. We do something which is in some ways similar, and I try to advocate also because I wrote a book about privacy. And we have one of my colleagues. She is what is it called? Data analyst, data scientist is the new name for this thing.
Yeah.
And so I try to advocate on collecting the less amount of money of data,
yes.
Which, by the way, is the new money. And so do you think it's we should be more bullyish, those of us who cares, like me, like you, inside of companies, to like hit the table sometime and say, no, we don't do this. Because you said, yeah, I want to keep my job, but really, none of us in this room would have a problem to get another job tomorrow.
Except from the guy who doesn't code. But
you can learn to code.
Too late. Anyway, I think that everybody has their lines. And this is a huge debate right now as we speak in the gaming community in Israel, because we don't really have a gaming industry. We have a casino industry. This is like 90% of people work in the casino, online casino industry. And you know, it's where you put your red lines. And eventually, I mean, I would not sell weapons. I will make addictive apps, and I'm saying it because it's I need to eat.
Which is a mental weapon.
It is. And you'll be surprised. I've been approached by devious organizations to make games for them for different reasons. And this I did not take. But yes, I've made addictive games. I received, and at the time I was very proud of the emails that I received about angry fathers saying we're milking their kids, and I'm like, yeah, good game design. I was a little bit younger, but then again, I felt pride in my work, and I still do. So it makes you, wonder.
Can we get the mic back in the front for Daniel? Thank you for the talk and for sharing your experience of being the good guy now, even though you were potentially the bad guy in the past, because all of us has done something in the past ethically.
I'm still not a saint. Come on. I mean,
you're going there.
Yeah, when I retire, I will not make games that make people. Yeah, I try. Yeah, I try to, but seriously.
It's not about being perfect. It's about striving to be.
It's hot. It is, like, it is hot.
The mic here, is it on? It's red, and it doesn't work. Well, but the good thing with you, Daniel, is you're not so far away from the... So we can use this...
Oh my God, it's like a
old technology. Wait. Only for you, Daniel, we will use old technology.
There are many good things about me. Can you talk to using these ideas for good or bad in other areas like teaching, like speaking?
Yeah.
Are there things that you say we should take away from that? Things that you'd say, no, it's not really applicable?
Yes, this is actually what I'm trying to focus right now. I'm trying to improve my life and other people's life with gaming. I completely gamified my morning routine of exercise, and it's been working, as you can see. I mean, it has many good use. I tried to look at my business as if it was a game. Not like the failing part, but my goals, concrete goals, and like intermediate and further away goals. Look at my incomes and outcomes, that if there were like a game economy, it really helps me focusing my mind on my business, looking in this way. And yes, of course, like the recycling project was amazing. I mean, I was skeptic at first, but when you see the results of your game design that actually impacts real world problems, this was really it almost compensated for the puny money they paid me to do it. Almost. If that answers your question, Daniel.
All right. Well, let's see. Yeah, we'll do a last question. But for that last question, I will have to do something very technical. So you hold the mic.
And I replace the batteries.
So
in the meantime, you get to...
If there are any. I don't know if there are any.
You get to whistle or whatever, sing something.
One time in band camp.
The good thing about this is we do video editing on the videos. And the other good thing about this is I am not editing. Another
ex-colleague. Wow, I think I lost like 5 pounds.
It's rebooted.
Amazing. Let's see if it works. Thanks.
Check. Works. Do you think that the time is changing actually right now, that people realize that they are getting ripped off, and that's why a lot of games change to, instead of money, to watch ads instead?
No, the watch ads games are hyper casual games usually that are like, it's one hit, you play them for a day or two and that's it. And these are really hard, it's really easy, relatively easy to make. A lot of developers are doing it because you don't have to make a game as a service. You have all kinds, really, but what is for certain is that you will have more gamers as like we go on forward. Now, actually, a third of the planet is considered to be a gamer, and I think this number is going to be like way more. So there will be people really harvesting on getting money from people using all kinds of tactics. They will be great games, great, you know, entertainment games. They will be everything. If one thing I'm certain is that everything is going to be like a huge online game, like very, very soon. Every industry. So this is maybe why I like what I do so much, because I think that this is really ubiquitous.
Yeah. So the ads are actually then on top of the games for the people who don't want to pay real money, so they pay with watching ads to unlock some features or whatever.
Yeah, video rewards, you want to learn alive. These games were like this from the get-go. When you played arcade games, the games were expensive. You had to pay a quarter, play for 2 minutes, die, and then put another one. This never changed. It's been like this for 40 years, 50. All right, last one.
The very last one.
Make it short, okay?
I actually have
ask a question where you have to say yes or no.
One question.
No, go ahead.
One question. Okay. What is your game life balance after acquiring the knowledge of game addiction?
I'm not playing enough for sure. I'm serious. I'm serious. I'm not playing enough. I have this one or two game nights. And then I can squeeze in like 2 or 3 hours, like midweek, like playing a game that I love to play on my PC or something like that. And now I don't do the mobile games. But since I do what I do, I need to play the mobile games also. But I'm not playing enough. Ideally, I would have been playing like pre-kids me. Would have played that 20 hours per week, and I would have been satisfied with this. Now I'm aiming for like 7 or 8. Yeah. That's good. Gaming is good. I don't want you to come out of the thing that this is the devil. No, no, no. Games are great for your soul, your body, your mind. It's great. Just the right games. Yeah.
We could go on and on and on. About
yeah, I'll
this.
Be. I'll be here. Yeah. I'll be here. It's been lovely. Thank you very much for having me.
Giving a round of applause.